welcome to the epic, awesome show, anime podcast number
207.
I'm Zain, along with me is
Teketria.
Yeah. You know, you've been here long enough, you don't get a really cool thing anymore. You're just a new person. Yeah. You're just a normal person that's here. So, yeah. How does that make you feel?
Feels normal.
Great.
Everyday life.
I don't know where I was going with that. A lot of times, well, anybody who knows this now, yeah, I still have no idea where I'm going with most things. So, this week we're actually talking about some really cool stuff. Some of my favorite things to talk about. But before we get into that, you know the title of this podcast. And so you know exactly, you know Teketria, what we're talking about. But for anybody out there, you know, you'll know the title as well. We'll be talking a little bit about the Fullmetal Alchemist versus Brotherhood, which is something that I'm super excited to talk about. But before we get into that, let's start with some of the anime that we watched this week.
Yeah.
So, one of the first animes I think I watched this week, and really, because I mean, we're going to be talking about Fullmetal Alchemist because I've been watching a lot of it for preparation for this podcast, and also because I was really wanting to rewatch it again because it's been, I want to say it's been like 4 or 5 years since I've rewatched it. It has been a very long time, but one of the series is I've actually gotten the chance to watched was The God of High School. And I swear, The God of High School just keeps getting more ridiculous every week.
Oh yeah, it has some Dragon Ball levels of power scaling.
It does, and it is quite enjoyable. I will say, for a lot of the anime that I tend to watch, it tends to be God of High School, ReZero, and Rent a Girlfriend, mostly because God of High School is just a ridiculous mess. Even into episode 10, which kind of goes into the thing of, this is what I am fighting for. I am fighting for my friend. Now we gotta fight for apparently myself. I don't know. Lot of times it's really hard to keep track of, you know, and it's just weird because apparently he comes back stronger because I think he won the fight, but I'm not 100% sure if he was down all the way because then Bright Light came through and then he was transformed.
I mean, they're getting into some of Jinmori's cooler powers.
Yeah.
He gets some pretty ridiculous stuff. I'm not going to spoil what it is.
I mean, I will say his originals are the most original names I've ever seen. Like, Jinmori's original, One Dragon. Jinmori's original, Two. Two Dragons. His third one is Three Dragons.
I'll say this. Jinmori, his powers are going to drive something similar to the inspiration for Goku. If you know what that is, good for you. And if not, don't worry about it. Don't look it up. it gets pretty ridiculous, which is cool because, you know, God of High School gets pretty good keep going on, probably up until the end of its tournament arc, but its tournament arc lasts forever, so that's fine.
Yeah. The thing is, with the tournament arc, the one thing I can say about it is that it is very predictable, so, I mean, anytime they're going to try to add any type of, be like, ooh, is he going to survive? I do not know. Ooh. It's usually just like, we know you're going to survive. like this is so predictably dumb that, granted, being predictable doesn't mean that, you know, some of my favorite series are predictable.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think of some series that are actually that I've watched that, you know, you can see where the ending is coming from and you can see a lot of different things, yeah. But it's the ride it's just fun. I think it's a great example of
Oh, yeah.
Being very predictable.
I mean, It's one of those shonens where like the plot kind of doesn't matter. You're there for the ride.
Especially because in My Hero, they tend to in the very beginning be like, "Oh, this is my story of how I became the number one hero in the world," and it's like, "Okay, so you're becoming number one hero." So anytime they try to like act like, "Oh no, Deku might die," dude, you already told us you're the number one hero in the world, so you know the fact that you're not gonna die.
Yeah, I mean,
it's gonna be like, I have a thing for My Hero, and it's called Deku Ex Machina for My Hero.
I mean that definitely is a thing. I mean some of the more predictable stuff is like, you know, Bakugo, he's a very predictable character, but people love him because of his personality. Mr. Explosion Murder King himself draws quite a bit of fans.
Yeah. Which, it's granted, like, in the movie, I don't know, did you watch the new movie of My Hero?
Which one was that?
Not Two Heroes. It's here.
now that
there's... Heroes Rising.
Now that there's more than one, I have to actually keep track of them.
It was Heroes Rising.
I think I watched Two Heroes. I don't think I've watched Hero Rising yet.
Okay, so in Heroes Rising, Deku Ex Machina comes in hard. But a lot of stuff with Bakugo and my goodness, and Deku. Yeah. I almost forgot his name there, because I'm like, wait, I was upset Midoriya, which is fine. And then I was like, wait, but like I almost forgot how to actually what his actual name was, and I'm like,
Midoriya is his actual name.
Yeah, it is his actual name. But the fact that the similarities between Bakugo and Deku are very, very similar characters.
I mean, they grew up together, so I mean, one of the things about it is they're going to be eventually having certain, like, essentially Bakugo is more of like a foil to Midoriya. Midoriya even has like inner monologue that says, "Yeah, I look up to you. I'm going to emulate a bit of you so I can surpass you." So you see him actually like emulate some of Bakugo at certain points, straight up, where he's just straight up copying his like fighting moves and all that. They'll eventually have certain parts where it's like that for sure.
I mean, granted, I know that, and I mean, I know the fact that. With My Hero, you know, and the fact that Deku and... Well, granted, this movie takes place, I think, after season 5, I think? It's somewhere between... Sense. I think it's somewhere between... it's not at all season 4. Season 4 is nowhere to be seen with that one. I think it is season 5. It might be after season 5. But because there's certain things that haven't happened yet that he's gotten his hands on. Certain tech that he doesn't have on... in the end of season 4, or he gets it towards the end of season 4.
Yeah.
And so there's certain things that, you know, I don't know exactly what exactly is going on with it, because it fits into the story, but I'm just not 100% sure where.
Yeah, I think it would be somewhere around the season 5 mark. Generally, they're considered, like, slightly non-canonical, because they're not part of the manga, blah, blah, blah. But, like, they do fit in the anime universe, technically, of, like,
well, I think a lot of their, like, Two Heroes fits perfectly into the series, and so does, I believe, so is Two Heroes Rising as well.
Yeah, they're meant to fit in there, so, like, to me, they're pretty much part of the canon. Yeah. I mean, the main thing is, so, it's actually kind of funny. I guess this was a topic that we didn't think that would come up, but, I'm actually going to reference a One Piece arc here. There's a arc right after Skypiea that is a really well done arc.
Mm-hmm.
It's like it fits into the story real well. That's kind of how the movies are to me. They're you know, part of that canon area where they you know, they're done well enough that you can totally see them in the canon.
Yeah.
They're just technically not written and adapted from the manga. But yeah. they're done well enough, in my opinion, that like they can fit in the canon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, So, going back to a little bit of the God of High School, as I said, like, episode 10, I just don't see anything really worth... I mean, it's decent enough. It's a very much more... I think the best way to describe the God of High School is a popcorn series.
I'd say it's, like, if you want to see, like, an abridged level of, like, how the Dragon Ball scaling works,
mm-hmm.
it ramps up pretty quick. So I'd say it's more like that to me, where yeah. if you want to see a quicker version of a Dragon Ball fight, there you go. Because, like, yeah, Dragon Ball fights
yeah.
originally started as martial art fights. Goku was originally a martial artist before he started throwing ki blasts everywhere.
And then basically going from actually having a martial arts fight to having a yelling fight, then finally going into a martial arts fight.
Yeah. It definitely started out more as a martial arts thing.
Yeah.
God of High School is similar to that. So, like, if you're not into the original Dragon Ball fights, you might not be into the original or the start yeah. of God of High School.
I will say, though,
it will ramp up, actually, to some of those Dragon yeah. Ball level fights if you stick with it.
Yeah, I will say that the fight scenes for the show is definitely 100% one of the best things about the show.
Oh, heck and yeah.
I would say that alone is worth watching.
I think it definitely helps carry it.
Yeah, I can see for a lot of people it being like, it's weird, but it might be a little too weird for some people, which I can totally understand that. So, what's a series that you were able to catch this week?
So I mentioned this 2 weeks ago. I'm still on it. I'm going through Durarara right now.
Mm-hmm.
It is a lot chunkier than I remembered. The second season is quite a bit larger than the first season. That's probably why. But
oh, yeah.
The first season covers some pretty cool stuff. It's pretty dark. Second season, it picks up right after the first season, which I love. They don't have to skip over anything. It introduces some of my favorite characters. Specifically, it has Isaiah's little sisters, which are both very interesting and very very crazy characters. Isaiah also having a very interesting English voice. He is same voice as Lelouch and Ichigo. He brings that kind of energy that I had with Lelouch. He does it pretty well.
Johnny Ambassador?
Yeah, yeah. The English voice is done very well in my opinion. And him and Yuri Lowenthal, who voices mm-hmm. Shinra, they do amazing jobs on the English casting.
Yeah.
They really helped that experience for me, I think. Because one of the things is, I love watching Durarara in English. And, you know, sub versus dubs. I lean a lot towards English subs because a lot of the time voice acting might not have good direction. I never say that the voice actors themselves are bad, but
how dare you?
The direction sometimes isn't good.
I didn't even know. I thought I brought you onto this podcast and didn't know about your opinions on dubs for subs.
But like, holy crap, this is one of the dubs I love probably the most. And it's one of the few that I just straight up will watch and dubbed. I mean, technically, if there's good direction, I will always watch it in dub.
Mm-hmm.
It just depends on the direction for me. It's not necessarily who's voicing who.
Mm-hmm.
It's how you utilize your voice actors.
Oh, yeah.
And I think Durarara does it very well.
I mean, I would even say now, a lot of dubs now tend to use their voice actors very well. Anything done by Funimation and Sentai, both are great. Both have, usually you'll get a very solid, if not A+, anime dub.
I'll say this. Directing has come a long, long way since its previous times, but
mm-hmm.
it just depends. Like, there's still times where you can find bad dubs. Like, I don't think it's as much of a roll of the dice anymore, thankfully.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Thankfully, it's not that anymore, but it's always something that you look out for. Sometimes they utilize their voice actors really well. sometimes not as good. I think Durara, despite coming out in 2010, utilized it very well.
But even in 2010, like
2010 was a little bit more of the roll of the dice than it is right now.
But I will say a lot of stuff that came out of Bing Zoom, I think that was one of the ones that came out of Bing. And nine times out of 10 for Bing Zoom stuff, it's usually pretty solid.
Yeah, that's one where, like, for that one, they do the dub pretty well. I can honestly say that. And I've been enjoying my rewatch. It's been so nice. It's also very unique because, you know, you're following multiple different main characters. Having a bunch of different stories is something that a lot of anime doesn't necessarily do.
Mm-hmm.
It's usually follow a main character, maybe see the life of a few other characters. This one is like, what if we had, you know, like four or five different interconnected stories? And it does it really well. That's why I stick with it.
I mean, that's the reason why I liked Darling in the Franxx. Because it kind of went off from the main two characters, which I still think are the worst two characters. They're just not very good.
I mean, it is one of Trigger's it's not one of their best works by far. But
yeah, but the side characters are honestly the best characters in the series, because I think they're more interesting, they're more dynamic. Yeah.
They definitely help redeem a lot of what the main characters don't bring.
Yeah.
I mean,
I do believe that the main characters like Zero, Two, and Hero are just very one-dimensional.
Yeah. Well, I mean, in a sense, they're, you know, action heroes. They're not.
Yeah.
They don't do anything besides that. That's why I kind of like the side characters, though I wish they could go more into them.
Yeah.
What about you? What's some other stuff you've been going through?
Another series I've been going through is the season 2 of ReZero. I'm right now on episode 35. And basically going, I know hell. I mean, it's a little bit different of an episode from the last... No, not the last. I think it was the last episode? Or the episode before that one. Where I think it's 33 that ended just... It was just super heavy ending. It was definitely one of those endings where it was just like... Subaru was just breaking down and he was just losing it. And the fact that somebody, he could tell the secret to somebody, like he was so relieved that he could tell him, it's like, oh, I die. And then not die, not having him die or the person die.
Yeah.
And going into this one, it kind of goes a little bit more into the relationship between Subaru and, oh my goodness, can't remember her name now. Amelia's. There we go. Best girl.
Yeah.
See, even agree with you.
So many people would disagree with you online.
Oh, I know. I mean, are you kidding me?
So many people.
James, like, he's been, I think, I don't know if he's actually ever been on the podcast, but we reference him a lot. And he tells me, he's like, no, you're wrong. I want the girl that's going to kill me. You know, and then we just go, yeah, white people. But no, it's just like, I still think she's the best girl, though. But, you know, granted, I know I have weird tastes and my, you know, my sense of taste is times very small of what actually a lot of people really, really like versus, you know, what's actually good. But hey, that's a whole nother rabbit hole for another thing. But that
can be a whole episode on its own.
Probably going into my tastes and dissecting it and just seeing like, what does this mean? Does this mean I was hurt when I was little? Possibly. Dropped on my head a few times.
Taste is subjective, but there's a lot of waifu wars that go on. So.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
There's a lot of the waifu wars and.
And that's why I just don't say what my waifu is. Problem solved.
Well, I mean, honestly, the best waifu that you could ever have, Aqua from Birth by Sleep.
Like I said, I'm just not going to mention my taste. Makes it easier.
You are a coward. That is what you are.
Unpopular opinions will get stoned, so.
I mean, you know how many times I've gotten stoned?
I mean,
first few times.
In what way are we talking about? What kind of stoned are we talking here?
Depending. I mean, it can be both ways, you know. but going back to ReZero here.
A lighter subject.
Oh, yeah. So much lighter than being stoned. Yeah. I don't know. my track. Kids thought. On track here. Okay. So, oh my goodness. This is going off the rails really quickly. So episode 35, I think, is going into a really nice going into more of Subaru and Amelia's relationship, and him actually, honestly, him just getting to a point where it's like, okay, let's just get this done, and I just don't care about my life right now, because if I die, I just keep coming back, so go ahead, kill me. And there's certain relationships that you do see that are just like, ooh, him standing up to the guy that basically, I think, almost killed him the last life. Or very close to killing him the last life, and then he's like, yeah. Oh, now I see what actually angers you and does all this stuff here, and it's just like, just to kind of egg him on a little bit. It's like, go ahead, kill me, I don't care. And just in his mannerisms and how much he's changed from the very first episode of even just the season,
yeah,
to now.
I mean,
is a very much different. You have very much a different character, and it's such a unique series that.
I mean, Subaru has gone through a lot. And a lot of isekais give, you know, an overpowered protagonist. He is the opposite of that. He is so powerless. And that gives a very good dynamic. It really helps ReZero stand out.
It does. But it also does help that the fact that when he's dying, you know, all time and time again, and the fact that his character is able to change, and because he remembers everything, because the episode ends with him talking to Beatrice.
Yeah.
And with the possibility of, you know, relining up with Beatrice, and which I'm wondering if she's going to wind up not in the library anymore after this. Which is something that I kind of find interesting.
Yeah, that might happen. Beatrice has an interesting origin. Is really cool to explore.
Mm-hmm.
She definitely has a lot of potential to go through. You can definitely see a lot of what could happen with her.
Yeah, there's a lot of really cool stuff there. But what's another series that you've watched this week?
So one that I highly recommend anyone watch in subs, because finding the dub for it is a mess, is Gintama, which is one that I've started rewatching as well.
Yeah, that is a mess.
Me and Zain have both looked through all of the dubs with a friend to figure out where they all exist, and it is scattered across pretty much multiple different platforms.
Yep.
So it's the equivalent of trying to find the Dragon Balls, but for a dub. So I just recommend watching it subbed.
Except there's certain things that just don't exist, I think. There's certain dubs that just don't exist.
Certain parts of the dub, I think, don't exist. Yeah.
So it becomes a very much a Easter egg of being like, ooh, Hulu has some. Well, then now it's over to High Dive for the movie. Crunchyroll has a few.
Yep.
And yeah, three different sites, and that's not everything.
Yeah. But it's a pretty good series. It's very interesting because it starts out as a comedy. And it started out in Shonen Jump, so it's a shonen. It's meant for boys, but it started out as a comedy. It then went to action, and it does it really well. It has some really good emotional beats.
Mm-hmm.
And then it goes back to being comedy for a bit, and then it gets serious. Not necessarily in action, all action arcs. And near the end, it becomes mostly action. But it still keeps up a lot of its comedy qualities. It's so unique in what it is, and it's probably going to, no matter what, stay in like my top five, maybe even top three anime like forever.
Yeah.
Like it's wholly unique, yet at the same time, it kind of makes you say like, what is this? But also it's like, man, this is really good and I can't stop watching. And it's a lot of that.
Yeah.
It's very special to me, I think, because it's also just one of those, like, ones that fits a lot of different tastes, but also probably one that made me laugh when I needed a good laugh. So yeah, there's that.
Nice.
If you ever decide to watch it, I believe Crunchyroll has all of the episodes subbed.
I believe it does, yes.
If you need a quick way to watch it, just watch it on Crunchyroll subbed. It will make your life easier than trying to find a dub for it.
So another series that I've actually gotten a chance to watch and have a lot of fun with, and I've actually made it about halfway before we even started, you know, doing the podcast, was Rent a Girlfriend.
Oh, yes.
This episode, honestly, I really like it. For the fact that Friend's Girlfriend basically is the name of the episode, and it kind of goes into the whole thing of where the main character... Oh my goodness, now I'm trying to actually remember these characters' names, and like I have like names in my head, and it's just like...
Oh yes, your protagonist that's so basic.
Yeah.
It's easier to remember everyone else's name but them.
Yeah, but also it's harder for me to remember a lot of this too, especially because I'm going through like multiple different series and it's just like, yeah.
I mean, that's...
So it's Kazuya?
Yeah.
And basically Kazuya basically takes Mizuhara and basically has her go on a date with his friend. Because basically he's been, ever since Ruka basically declared her love to him, and basically went to his school, found him, and his one friend they both double date on, she thanked him for the date, for being, you know, basically telling Kazuya that she was his rent-a-girlfriend.
Mm.
Which absolutely shatters the poor guy. And this is kind of, you know, where he goes on a date with in a way to basically tell him that, oh, he's been renting her, kind of. And I think it'll wind up being a really cool... I don't know how exactly the episode ends.
Yeah.
Since how I made it about halfway through and trying to do multiple things, you know, trying to... With subbed anime, this is the reason why I like dubbed so much, though. You can do so much more multitasking on dubbed and not having to pay close attention because you can actually hear what's going on. You know, you don't have to...
Yeah, it can paint a really good picture and you can, mm-hmm. you know, do something else.
Yeah.
I do that sometimes, actually.
Especially because I was actually doing a lot of other stuff during, you know, with ReZero, which was a mistake, and God of High School, which was, I think it's about, you know, normal. I got about the normal amount that I would normally get from God of High School, just like, huh, neat, and continue. That's kind of how I feel about God of High School sometimes. But this series, it's surprising me along the way that how much heart the series does have, and the fact that you can read it on Crunchyroll as well, which is something I really like too. And I'm hoping that this series, we get another season of it, or how it ends perfectly to where we don't really need a season two. But if we get season two of this, I think I will absolutely be in love with it. I would want more.
I know there's a spin-off manga for it, so I'd be interested in getting that animated.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe not immediately, but after like a season two, I'd be pretty interested in seeing that animated.
Yeah.
This definitely has a lot of heart into it. I think it's partially because the creator doesn't have a lot of stuff, and hitting success, what, he's around his 30s.
Yeah.
Hitting success around then is very nice because in the competitive industry that is, you know, anime and manga, mm-hmm. Especially in Japan, hitting something that can get an anime adaptation even in your 30s can be considered young at times.
Miyazaki, yeah.
Yeah, but I can definitely see you know, the passion that's in here. Mm-hmm. It definitely is something that, like, you know, putting a little bit more extra consideration in, since it's serialized and all that.
One thing I would love to see, though, is this is definitely a series where I really want to see it dubbed. And I know a dub's coming because they've just started working on the dub with it.
Yeah.
And the reason why is because you see stuff that's going on, the characters' reactions, and there's a lot of physical comedy in this. That there's going to be some physical comedy that I've hit that, like, watching it the second time through, dubbed, will be like, oh, I didn't catch that one. Or I didn't catch this part to it. And there's certain parts to it that I just will not have caught, because it's the same thing with Monthly Girls Nozaki-kun. There's a ton of jokes I caught the second time watching it dubbed than I did the first time watching it, even though I absolutely laughed all the way through. Like, this one is less of that type of comedy, but the fact that they go through their mind of being like, what they're actually thinking in the little, you know, in the bubble up ahead, which is something that most anime doesn't do.
Yeah.
I actually really like that. It helps it stand out, definitely. Yeah.
I think with the current pace they're going, mm-hmm. I think what Rent a Girlfriend has 17 volumes currently, and they're on pace to, I think, adapt a good chunk of it, actually.
Right now, I can actually see here,
because episode 8 is Christmas, and that is volume 4, so. Considering how much they actually have left, they probably can animate probably a good chunk in season 2, actually, if they're on this pace. So it's actually very real that they can push out a season 2 relatively quick. Oh, I forgot.
It's actually not available on... That's my bad. It's actually not available on Crunchyroll. The manga is... I'm not sure where it's at, because it's by Kodansha.
Yeah.
So let me see here. Actually, I'm on here, so... I can actually already look at it. See how many. Right now they have 17 volumes, and they're up to 148 chapters. And chapters that yet to be published in a volume format are basically up to 149.
Yeah, they have a good chunk.
My bad. 154. My bad.
Yeah. But Christmas is around volume 4. That's episode 8. So going off that pacing, you know, by the time that they're done, they probably will still have a good chunk of volumes that they could animate. So I can see a pretty realistic season 2 coming out within a reasonable amount of time.
I do feel like the series has been doing really, really well. And what's really even funny is go to any episode of Rent a Girlfriend on Crunchyroll, and you will have fun in the comments.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
It's always about, I do not like Memory-chan, or I do not like, okay, this one comment here on episode 10. To other people, please do not let your disgust with the mommy spammers stop you from enjoying the show. I mean, there's certain things like that. It's just like, so many people just literally.
I think it has a good community to back it. Comedies are a little bit more lighthearted on the community side, so that's always good.
Yeah. So what's another series that you've actually watched this week?
So besides Gintama, recently with a few friends, we started rewatching Nichijou, which is a comedy. In a different vein than Gintama. Gintama is about, like, the jokes itself. Nichijou is about having a, like, relatively minimalistic art style, with mundane stuff, but the jokes are generally turning those mundane into, like, more serious things.
Mm-hmm.
So all the art is pretty minimalistic. Sometimes the eyes are literally just, like, straight lines, but they put a lot into their animation, and I mean a lot. So, for instance, there's a scene where the main character, she is eating her lunch, and she has her sausage shaped like a squid, and it slips out of her chopsticks. And the whole scene is very epic anime, kind of like animation stuff. Mm-hmm. Just about her trying to grab it back with her chopsticks and it slipping out, going like shooting out to one of her friends who tries to catch it with a baseball mitt, like a catcher's mitt. And it squeezes out of that. And it's like this whole thing where it's just this extremely highly well animated scene for catching a hot dog, yeah, or like a little sausage thing for your school lunch. it's stuff like that. It's turning like your average mundane thing into like an extreme. It's styled as a 4-coma but in animated format, so it's like having like a bunch of shorts in one episode.
Yeah.
So you might see like, you know, 4 to 5 different things in shorts in an episode. That's the format for it. It's nice, it's light. I would recommend it if you just want something light to watch.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing super heavy. And it's, you know, done a lot better than other 4-coma ones that a lot of people might dislike, like Umaru-chan. I personally like Umaru-chan, by the way, but I have an obsession with 4-comas, so...
I mean, Umaru-chan is one of those things where it's like, to me, isn't a bad... I don't mind it. I mean, definitely not one of my favorites that I've actually sat down. And granted, have I really sat down and watched it? No, but it's not
It has an obnoxious main character, but if you don't mind that, it's pretty nice.
I've seen a lot of series with obnoxious main characters. I will say main characters that are annoying, I usually tend not to like.
Yeah.
But I mean,
with Umaru-chan, the main difference between this and like Nichijou is you have 3 main characters. They split up being stupid and having their antics versus like one character that you might dislike, mm-hmm, but you're stuck with. Like having a dislikable character is not bad. There's a lot of things that do it well.
Yeah.
If you ever played like the God of War series, mm-hmm, Kratos is like a very unlikable character. I don't think many people like him that much.
But
he has a lot of redeemable qualities that make him like an interesting or good character in a sense. Umaru-chan doesn't really have those. But I mean, as a person who likes 4-comas,
mm-hmm,
I'm not trying to take anything seriously, so I think that helps me enjoy it a little bit more.
Definitely.
Yeah. And there's another 4-coma one that's I like as well. But like I would say with Nichijou, the main thing to note about it is it takes some of the mundane stuff that you have and turns it into like very extreme scenes. And that is where a lot of the comedy in it is. So if you like people overreacting to stuff, it will be amazing.
It depends on how it's done. A lot of the times for me, when people overreact and all that stuff, a lot of times it depends on how it is done.
Yeah, that's fair. I guess in this one, another example is like, there's this one girl who, when she shows her frustration, she pulls out many different kinds of like guns or artillery.
Mm-hmm.
Like she has a pocket version of like a missile launcher or like a heavy machine gun that she will just pull out of thin air to shoot at this one guy who she disagrees with all the time. There are other times where like, one of the main characters, she likes drawing yaoi and she's very embarrassed about it. So whenever someone will like notice it or like she is afraid of it, you get extreme scenes where she might like chase them down, or in one case she does amazing acrobatics to hide the fact of what she's drawn.
Mm-hmm.
And she will go to great lengths to hide it, and it leads to some pretty funny scenes as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, like Nichijou's probably one of those like just you know, nice relaxing ones where if you just want to watch a bunch of dumb shorts, it's great. It's great for that.
Yeah. So with that being said, do you have anything else, any other series you want to add to that before we get into the main event?
I think that those are the main ones I wanted to cover. There might be a few that I'll cover next week, but like,
okay. So without further ado, let us get into the main course of what we're actually talking about here today. And that is the basically Fullmetal Alchemist versus Brotherhood.
Oh, yeah.
So a lot of times what you're going to hear us say, you're going to hear us interchangeably with, you'll hear a lot with this with O3, which is always referring to the original Fullmetal Alchemist anime. And then you'll hear FMA, which will be always used for the original Fullmetal Alchemist anime. And Brotherhood will always be used for the second anime adaptation of Fullmetal Alchemist.
Yeah, Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood.
Yes.
Yeah.
But it's always easier than saying, you know, through, and because we're always going to be interchanging them, because we're always going to be talking about the manga. We're always going to talk a little bit about the stuff that's in the FMA, and then what's in the stuff that's actually in Brotherhood as well. So,
yeah,
there's a lot to talk about here, and all we're talking about is from episode for FMA, we're going to talk about all the way up to 33, and for Brotherhood, we're actually only going up to episode 14.
Yep. There's more that can be talked about, but a lot of major differences are in that beginning area.
Yeah, but I mean, there's going to be other stuff that we'll probably talk about later. And a later on a later podcast, but I'm not sure when, if it'll be in the week after or even going further down the line, because there's a lot to there's just a lot of content to go through with both these series because of the fact that they're so long.
Yeah, there's a lot to go over. Probably not enough for one podcast, at least.
Definitely not enough for one podcast. So that's the reason why the cutoff there is episode 33 and 14. And the reason why that is, respectively, is because of where they diverge from each other.
Oh, yeah.
And, so one thing that's really cool about Fullmetal Alchemist and going through these characters, there are a total of 5 5 characters in this series. That's in the anime only, that are only anime characters. That's it.
Yeah. And to preference real quick, the O3 anime and Brotherhood, they differ quite a bit. But Brotherhood, for anyone who doesn't know, is a more direct adaptation of the Fullmetal Alchemist manga, whereas in the O3 anime starts taking creative liberties very early on.
Yeah.
In fact, some of these anime-only original characters that were mentioned show up as early as, like, episode 9. Mm-hmm. I think some are maybe even earlier.
I can actually tell you right now. Do I actually have this one? I do actually have the first one basically is... I don't think her name is Dante in this, because there's a lot of spoilers there. In case anybody has not seen the original Fullmetal, I have not seen FMA, then... It's going to be a lot of spoilers there. I don't remember her name.
Ah, yes. Spoiler alert for everyone. Was it the one that is like Yoki's companion, right?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. She appears in episode 9 originally. Yep. Her name is Lyra.
Lyra, thank you.
She is an apprentice alchemist, I'm pretty sure. So she has like a little thing instead of drawing.
Her necklace.
Yeah. It's very interesting because, like, she's a minor character that becomes partially a major character as time goes on.
Mm-hmm.
But she appears as early as episode 9 in the original anime. And it's funny because, like, she appears nowhere in the manga. And the Yoki arc is actually, like, very small and simple.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is very much, I would say it's very different from the anime, but then you go to the basically Russell and Fletcher Tringham, they basically are only in episode 11 and 12, which is great because the end of 12 is great because of the fact that he's younger and taller than Ed, which, you know, it's just like, it's unfair, which I feel your pain. I feel Ed's pain. I really do.
I feel none of this pain.
Oh, I feel all the pain. Frank Archer. I don't remember who Frank Archer was. Now I actually have to look here.
Frank Archer is a person who appears, I think he appears as a cameo in episode 25, and fully gets his actual appearance in episode 26. And I believe he is, yeah, he's part of the military.
Oh, I think I know what you're talking about. He's the one that basically takes Hughes's place.
I think so, yeah.
In the series. Okay.
Yeah, he takes up his... partially takes it up. It's weird, but I guess that'll be explained later on.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, he...
Which is really funny is that he's actually voiced by Troy Baker, which is great.
Yeah.
It was a great time. And then Isaac McDougall, which is, I believe, the... Oh. Okay, so this one's exclusive to only to Brotherhood. Really? Oh, yeah, Isaac McDougall. That's basically the first character you actually see in Brotherhood.
Yeah, Isaac McDougall is a character that appears in the first episode of Fullmetal mm-hmm. Alchemist. He is a character that is... So the first episode of Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood, that episode is actually like unique to that anime,
mm-hmm.
Which is funny because it's supposed to be the one that is, you know, the direct manga adaptation. But that one is a pretty unique episode. There's a guy who, he is a freezing alchemist and he pretty much goes on a rampage, and it's the episode kind of just shows off. Hey, look, Ed and Al are alchemists. This is some of their powers to anyone who hasn't watched it before.
Mm-hmm.
And but it also
a great way to...
Yeah.
I would say that episode for Brotherhood is actually a really great way of fan service. I mean, that's really what a lot of it is basically just like going like, hey, you guys remember you remember Ed and Al? We're back! It's one of those things.
It is a really good way of doing that. Mm-hmm. It also just kind of introduces quickly some of the established characters that we'll explain some of the differences later on as well of about, you know, like, oh yeah, this is why Brotherhood is the way it is.
Oh yeah. So going into, let's start taking a look at some of the stuff that's in the original within FMA there. There's a lot of really cool stuff and a lot of really things, little slight things that are actually quite different to Fullmetal Alchemist that are actually have kind of Brotherhood does have a little bit of the same beats as FMA, because really Ed and Al having to witness a baby being born or being around when a baby is being born is almost, it's still just as funny in Brotherhood that it is in FMA. It might be a little bit more funnier in FMA because they're younger, but the fact that it does change the characters a little bit, especially with how FMA does going into the Those Who Challenge the Sun, going into the first part of the series itself when they go to trying to think of the name of that first city. It's where they have to deal with Cornello. It's not unreasonable, and Reasonable is where they're from.
This one is in the desert town of
Lior.
Yeah.
Lior. There we go.
Yeah.
I can remember things because I just, you know, watched it. Like I have a ton of things in my mind right now. It's hard to keep track of everything under the sun.
Yeah.
But when they go to the town of Lior, there's actually a huge difference between Brotherhood and FMA here. And in the manga adaptation, I don't really care for how they actually present Ed in Brotherhood and in the manga for this part here, because it really when he like talking to Rose, and the fact that they kind of had this dialogue with Rose before, it doesn't come off as much of a jerk or as much of an a-hole as in Brotherhood. Like, he's more of an a-hole in Brotherhood there, and in the manga as well.
Yeah.
Where it's like, you know, when he's going off in, you know, these things like that, it's like, you hardly know this person, and you're literally just saying, like, oh, God doesn't exist. And basically going through this and saying, like, oh, humans can be bought on the cheap and all that stuff, and it's just like,
Yeah.
It's like, it doesn't make him look very much like, just makes him look like an a-hole. I think that's the best way to describe it.
Oh, very much so. I think that's one of the things about Ed that is very unique, though, is also the fact that he, you know, he kind of is very open about his, like, if a god existed, why would he make me suffer the way I have?
Yeah.
He's very much like,
but he's also like the, because of that. Kind of guy. Well, he's also the kind of guy that at the very beginning of the series is very much so, alchemy can solve all problems. There's no problems alchemy can't solve. Well, especially because it's like him saying that it's a matter of time before humans are created.
A quick correction on that is,
mm-hmm.
He's actually pretty nihilistic, from what I see. He sees alchemy as only getting you so far until you have a philosopher's stone.
Mm-hmm.
But that's before he realizes and understands what a philosopher's stone is.
Yeah.
But like,
so
he believes that alchemy can only solve your problems up to a certain point.
Yeah.
And things like human transmutation are just no. but if you have a... He also believes that, like, he wants to... He's in this very, I want to defy God thing. So putting him in, like, real is a very interesting area because he's a person who straight up wants to defy any kind of, like, religion whatsoever. And then... when he learns, you know, about how philosopher stones work, he's like, oh yeah, that is flying too high to the sun. I should just not do that.
Yeah. But even going into the, basically going after that and going in back into the, where they go back into the past in FMA, I mean, they spend a lot more time on their past than, Brotherhood does.
Oh yeah.
I mean, granted, Brotherhood might do it towards the, maybe towards the middle of where I'm at right now. But, you know, comparing the two, you know, in the very, very beginning, this one tends to go into more of the connection that they had with their mother. And then going into something that's interesting that is in the manga is when they actually go on the train. But they do change things up a little bit because it's our first, episode 4 is our first introduction to Mace Hughes.
Yeah.
Which is a character
I love.
Oh yeah, I mean, I don't know if I don't know anybody who says, "Oh, Mace Hughes, worst character in Full Metal." like the original, like in the manga, I think he's just okay. Brotherhood, he's kind of just an okay character, but we'll come into that here shortly. But the one thing I love about FMA and what it does really well and goes into, you know, the whole train ride and Ed having to make the train in order to basically let the Fuhrer actually let him take the exam, I think is kind of a really cool thing because it's something that it makes sense in that world.
Yeah.
And how they, you know, how they really built this world and the fact that, you know, who's going to let a 10-year-old actually, I don't know if they're 10. They're really young, but it's like, I don't remember the actual age. They might be 12. I'm not 100% sure how old Ed actually is. I know they tell you how old he actually is, but.
I mean, at the start of the series, he's 15, but that's already when he is an alchemist.
Yeah, but that's, I'm talking about when before he's a state alchemist.
Oh yeah,
because in the manga, the train ride that they go on,
yeah,
he's already a state alchemist.
Yeah,
in the manga.
Yeah, as a state alchemist, I think I don't know if they actually say the exact age, but the one of the important things about it is he gets it pretty much as like the youngest to be
They actually do state his age.
Yeah.
At least in the in FMA, they do actually state his age. There's a lot of times when anytime they have a time skip or something like that, they do actually, they actually are sure to basically show both Ed and Al's age.
Yeah.
But the fact that we are an introduction to Hughes and kind of seeing his lovey-dovey nature is great. And it's something that the manga doesn't really show.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like it's something anime only. And it, just because of that, I would say the anime is almost superior to the manga. Just because of just because of that one character.
I would say that it's a lot easier to animate Hughes. But there's a lot of things that, you know, anime manga can differ in. Some are better than others. I think like near the end you can see some merits within the manga a lot more than maybe the anime.
Yeah.
But one of the things that's like really nice is that they can, you know, animate Hughes being Hughes a lot better than any manga panels really can.
Yeah. I mean, that is definitely for sure. Yeah. Then going into the whole Nita and Tucker thing between Brotherhood and Full Metal there, the one thing I think is done, I think it's FMA does it way better than Brotherhood does, because it the manga also kind of glosses over the whole Nita and Tucker thing, which I feel like in FMA, the whole Nina thing is a lot more harder, especially because Ed has actually been dealing with them for months versus days.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things that's very, very interesting about that part as well is it also kind of shows the dark sides of being an being a state alchemist, you know, like,
yeah,
I have to get my, I have to do my research, I have to submit my things so that I can, you know, get my government grants so I can live, you know, do my job.
Yeah.
And while it's very unfortunate what happens with Nina especially, yeah, I think that one of the cool things and also sad things that the 2003 one does is it kind of expands a little bit on what happens with her.
Yeah.
Now, I will say, still kind of is like, that's one of the few things that's like kind of sad and maybe even like a little bit touching for some people.
Which I think it does actually, which I think it's interesting because they are younger in FMA than in Brotherhood when this happens. So,
oh yeah.
The fact that when they have him really like going into a downward spiral because of the fact that he was not able to help her at all. And it's something that they're younger and he's less, you know, he's has seen less stuff. And in Brotherhood, I feel like it's just, it's not as, not as much of a punch, A, because, you know, we see it, we know what's coming, and B, it's because he's also older. So it's not as shocking. If that makes sense. To where it's like, oh yeah, you know, he gets, I mean, he still gets, it takes him, I don't know if it takes him a little bit to get over it, but it takes him, I feel like he takes it to heart a lot more, especially because, you know, going into the one after that, but also before that too, is that you have the whole thing where of Hughes and them actually knowing Hughes before Alicia was born. I think it's kind of one of those things where it's like, oh, okay. It's, it kind of leads to some fun times, especially because of the whole baby scene, the whole thing of a baby being born. It is Hughes' wife versus a complete stranger that they have to help out.
Yeah. I think one of the other interesting things that the 2003 anime does over Brotherhood, just in general, is like, It's a little bit less afraid to kind of be more gory. Because one of just as like a quick sidestep and back onto Nina, like the way they kill the Chimera at the end of that is a lot more graphic.
What, in FMA or Brotherhood?
In the 2003 Full Metal Alchemist.
Not really that graphic though.
It's actually a little bit more graphic the way that they kill her, because at the end of it, Scar kind of Rather, so I guess, like, you have to pay a little bit more attention. At the end of Brotherhood, or at the end of the episode in Brotherhood, Scar kind of does, like, a quick kind of killing, in a sense, like a mercy killing. Like, he reads a prayer, and he says, you know, like, hopefully these two can go to heaven, or something like that. It's very, it's, you know, a lot more wholesome than in the O3 anime, where he kind of blows them up in a much more like, you're going to kind of like, there are chunks left.
They don't show any chunks. It's just basically something on the wall.
Well, so there are chunks left though, because later on, little spoiler is that Chat Tucker survives some of this, and he, you know, takes those chunks and tries to clone them. Which is the, you know, it's like, oh man, that's when you realize, like, that's how it was done, it's like, oh man, that's really, really gory.
but it's not really shown though. That's one of the things that's really that it's like on Netflix, it will show like TV-14 because of gore, and I'm like, what gore? I mean, I guess it's got a little bit of gore, but Brotherhood, I think at times has more gore than FMA does. But going into
they swap, but like, oh man, early FMA doesn't shy away from some really horror scenes.
As we were saying before, when you go into the whole thing with Winry, when Winry comes into town after the Shao Tucker thing, and you have Barry the Chopper, or Barry the Butcher, whatever you want to call it, and the fact that, you know, he's actually going through the serial killer, you know, that him integrating Barry the Chopper into it, I thought was actually kind of cool. The fact that, you know, Ed has to basically get over his thing with Nina very, very quickly. Either that or die.
Yeah. I really like a lot of the beginning of Fullmetal Alchemist, because it both him and both like O3 and Brotherhood, because they show a lot of like the dark parts of alchemy, that are that like people commit on practically a daily basis, it feels like.
I mean, this right here, the whole thing with Barry the Butcher is nothing. It's not even the dark side of alchemy. It's just dark side of humanity.
it shows a lot of, well, I mean, Barry, the way Barry is put into like his suit of armor, similar to Alphonse. Alphonse is put in there as like an act of desperation. Barry is put in there because they're like, well, you know, if he's in the suit of armor, he can kill and guard our laboratory a bit better.
I will admit, though, Barry the Chopper is still probably one of my favorite characters, because I think he's really funny. fun character.
I find him a really great companion for the short time he's there. I wish that he stayed a little bit longer.
Yeah, but which is great, though, about Brotherhood is he comes back in Brotherhood. So, I mean, that's one thing. It's like, there's give and take with... there's really good things about Brotherhood that I think Brotherhood does a lot better than what FMA does. But another thing that I think Fullmetal, you know, does a lot better is... I mean, you have the Yoki scene, which is, you know... It's basically where his first... basically his first, I think it's one of his first big accomplishments is the whole the mining town, and getting basically them away from Yoki, and basically going into one of the first going into Lyra, who winds up becoming a more, you know, main character towards the, basically I would say even towards the end of the series.
Oh yeah, for sure.
But another thing I think they do really, really well, and that's something that I really love about it, is that they actually integrated two short stories from two side stories from the manga that Brotherhood never did. And this is Fullmetal versus Flame, where they expound on Hughes, and the fact that he gets this huge, huge portrait in the back of his daughter, and is like, no, it's like, it's great. It does something more than what that short story does. And granted, the end of the manga version of Fullmetal vs. Flame, it's literally him back in the office going on, like, knowing exactly, is like, you got to know when to leave. And yeah. So he's the only one not having to pick up the entire mess in the manga version. But I love the fact that that short story, they integrated it really well into the anime, along with one, I don't know if they actually, I think it is in earlier. It's in a later it's in a later one. I know it's there. Because I gotta actually figure out which one it is. If it's when he returns. But I think I may have already passed it? Did I already pass it? It's the one with the dog. So it's basically where basically Hawkeye gets the dog.
Black Panther.
Yeah. And I'm trying to remember. I know I already passed it, and I gotta remember where it actually is. Because it's like its own little thing. And oh wait, no, I think it's actually it's in the Full Metal versus Flame. That also is in there as well. So they do two things. I forgot about that. if Ed won, he would get the, you know, Roy had to keep the cat. So those were two short stories in one episode, which I really like. And I'm assuming there's another one in here as well with the Flame Alchemist, the Bachelor Lieutenant, and the Mystery of 23M Warehouse 13. I'm feeling those two are also a short as well. So that's something I also really like about it as well. Is they integrated a lot of the shorts that were in the manga that were like, you know, chapter 12.5, you know, something that doesn't really go with the manga that well. But I mean, with FMA, it does it really, really well.
The 0.5s are like little in-betweens that I really like those because as someone who likes reading a lot of manga can tell you, little 0.5s are generally like little things that people just enjoy having because it's, you know, it's nice to tell you when, like,
yeah,
in between two chapters, they're like, oh yeah, so 2 weeks happened, and you're like, what happened during those 2 weeks? And it's like, oh yeah, here's a 0.5. It's not a full chapter, but it'll tell you like what you want to know.
Yeah.
I like those.
I think
most manga readers will tell you that they enjoy those.
Yeah. But I love the fact that, you know, like, if you don't read the manga, like, I've not read the manga for Fullmetal Alchemist. Granted, with doing this stuff, I'm tending to actually have to do it more because there's a lot of comparison, you know, and there's a lot of these comparisons that you've got to do and figure out, okay, where does this, you know, where was this in the manga? If it was this ever in the manga, like the whole thing with the other brothers, Elric, I think is actually, it's one of those things where I don't think it really needs to be an FMA, but it's nice that it's there.
Yeah.
It just kind of adds more to flesh out the world. I think it's a great way. And it also kind of gives them more on like how the stone is made and, you know, the red water and a lot of the stuff here, but also going into the first, what a lot of people probably do say, the first divergence of the anime into FMA, where they start kind of going and diverging, even though I think they do diverge a little bit more because they do show Sloth.
Yeah,
I believe they show her early on. I believe I'm not 100% sure if they do or not, but earlier than the Warehouse 15 Warehouse the Warehouse saga, you know, after Ed gets his, because it's always interesting too, because the fact that they run into Tim Marco before they actually run into Tim Marco on their way back.
Yeah.
You know? In the original, they run into Tim Marco, I believe, before. Okay, the whole thing, they run into Marco, then they have to go because they run into Scar. I'm like having to remember two things, two stories, like Brotherhood and Full Metal, which is just, it's FMA. It's really like, it's bouncing my head around going, yeah. Bang, bang, bang. But because in FMA, they're not with, oh my goodness, I can't remember his name now. It's not Hughes. It's Armstrong. Cause they're not with Armstrong in the original in FMA, But in Brotherhood, they're with Armstrong. There we go. I don't know why. I think I'm overloading my brain with a lot of information.
I mean, it's what's interesting about the 2003 anime and Brotherhood, which is in 2009, is they have the same characters, they have the same setting, but they're just completely different stories. So it's actually very easily understandable that if you watch both concurrently, you're going to get confused a little bit.
Yeah, it is very.
And my recommendation for anyone who's listening to this is, we will have like a recommendation of, if you want to get like a manga experience versus like a different experience, we'll have like an episode drop off for you. So stay tuned for that.
So basically, going into the whole Tim Marco thing, which is funny that an FMA does have Armstrong there. Because that's where they have the confrontation with Scar, where Ed and Al both lose their, where they have to go to Reasonable to get their arm fixed by the Rock Bells, by Winry.
Yeah.
And one thing I love about Winry, and it's something that they use, I think, a little bit more in FMA than in Brotherhood, is how she uses her wrench. That wrench is a deadly weapon in Winry's hands. And it's great, especially when the wrench comes flying out and she's just like
there's a lot that is great with Winry.
Yes, Winry is a great character, and granted, I think it's probably Fullmetal Alchemist, I think, is one of those series where I don't think they had a lot of people where it's like, oh, they put a lot of people together with Ed. I think pretty much for, the ships together, they did. I think Ed and Winry were always the two characters that were like, yes, they need to end up together.
I mean, that's always
one of the big ships.
I have a few friends who are into Yaoi that could probably disagree with you, but I
granted, will I also know the ship later. Of Ed and Roy. So yes, I do know that ship. I know that a ship exists. And I just ignore that ship and say, you are wrong, but I will tell you 100% you're wrong, but that's a whole nother thing.
My Fujoshi friends will definitely disagree with you, but that's for a different time.
But they're just wrong,
I mean, listen, Yaoi sells well, so. there isn't a lot of people that are meant to be shipped with Ed. It's actually pretty clear that he's meant for Winry very early on. one of the things that's kind of interesting though is, he does have surprisingly a lot of people that travel with him though. It's on a rotating roster, but he does have a lot of traveling companions, and that's shown more in Brotherhood, I think, than in Fullmetal Alchemist.
Yeah, they do have a lot.
Fullmetal Alchemist, he's more alone with Alphonse, which is great because you get to see more of the brother dynamic.
Actually, towards like episode 16, he is traveling with Armstrong, and then after that, they are traveling with, after they get back to Central, and they go through that they're actually traveling with Winry for a while.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of different. They are traveling with different people, but.
Yeah.
They travel with Armstrong earlier.
Yeah.
They do traveling a lot more with people, with a lot more people in Brotherhood than they do actually in Fullmetal.
Yeah. I'd say in Brotherhood though, their traveling party is usually like, eventually it gets up to like 4 to 5 people at a constant.
Yeah, it does. It gets
pretty big.
Yeah, you are correct on that one. But I will say, though, going into this, after they meet Marco, and granted, I like the lines in FMA better when they're going into all the thing, because it starts going into Al and his doubting of, are these memories mine? Kind of thing, where they don't cover it much in Brotherhood, but they cover it in FMA, to where when it comes into later after Laboratory 5, where he actually starting to question where my memories fabricated, to where it's like in FMA, it's more to where Al has been thinking on this, you know, constantly, and then Barry kind of has to go over and just push it to the top. You know, pushes him over to the top to where it's like, what is real? What isn't real? Are these memories mine or are they different? You know, it's something that, you know, is very much so like, were these planted in my head now? But I will say, after they find out the notes for Tim Marco, I think how they treat that, the Tim Marco thing, is way better in Brotherhood, especially because they show you, they show you basically them going to town on these notes and having to actually work on it. In FMA, they don't really show that as much. They tend to be like, you know, they kind of gloss over it to where they, oh, they crack it finally to what, you know, to its humans that needed for the, basically the fake Philosopher's Stone, or for the Philosopher's Stone in general.
Yeah. There's like quite a bit of things that I think, there, like, I'd probably say early FMA, it has some very interesting parts to it. I'd say one of the things about early Brotherhood, also, I guess that hasn't been mentioned, is early Brotherhood kind of expects you to have watched at least some of the 2003 anime of Full Metal Alchemist. So if one of the things about watching Brotherhood is also, you know, if you're watching that one first, you'll probably actually not understand a few things that are happening.
Yeah.
Because it will kind of just jump into the Full Metal Alchemist world expecting for you to have understood some of it.
I will say, for the like the first scene of it going in from Full Metal to Brotherhood, I like them both, but I think Brotherhood's a little bit, I don't know. It's like, if you just want straight story, I would say FMA is probably the better first episode than Brotherhood is.
Oh yeah, Brotherhood just jumps to,
but Brotherhood also gives you that, that feeling of, yeah, nostalgia hit, or just something like, man, it's like you really want to come back into the world of Full Metal of FMA, and you actually get dive right headfirst into it.
Yeah,
with him on screen, him doing all of his with him being able to transmute without, you know, a circle and all that stuff. But granted, one thing I like about in FMA, I don't know if I like it. It's one of those things where it's like, I do like it a little bit. I like FMA a little bit better, especially when Ed doesn't know how to do it without a circle at the very beginning. He hasn't actually figured that out yet. But in Brotherhood, once he goes through the gate and has seen the truth, he knows how to do it automatically.
Oh yeah.
He can do it without a circle automatically, which is something I like about FMA a little bit better, because it does kind of tank to where, yeah, he is a prodigy, but there's certain things that just haven't clicked yet.
What one of the things about Brotherhood is, and I kind of like this kind of storytelling a little bit, is it does the storytelling technique of kind of starting in a middle area rather than in a beginning.
Yeah.
Full Metal Alchemist from 2003 straight up just starts at like in a very beginning area, and does, you know, traditional like rising plot thing. Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood starts essentially with its episode one, like in the middle of, or like in a starting area.
Yeah.
Stuff has already happened. And it doesn't tell you, but it slowly tells you, oh, this happened or that happened. And because it's a not traditional type of storytelling, it can definitely throw you off if you're not prepared for it.
Yeah. So going into Laboratory 5, them going to Laboratory 5, there's huge differences going into that between Brotherhood and FMA. Now with FMA, you have Scar on the loose still. So in Brotherhood, you actually don't have Scar on the loose at all, because Scar is all the way in East, I believe. I believe he's in East City, and in this series, he's actually in Central, and basically still hunting down Full Metal, and he's, you know, hunting down Ed, and not really Al, but just Ed at this point. And, you know, it's like you have the whole Laboratory 5 incident, and to where, you know, you go through the normal thing where they fight the suits, you have Barry come back, which both of those, you know, hit the same beat as Brotherhood does. But I think Brotherhood does it a little bit. Laboratory 5 feels a lot more anticlimactic in, that scene feels a lot more anticlimactic in Brotherhood than it does in FMA. Because there's a lot more stuff they actually explore in FMA that they don't explore in Brotherhood, especially with Ed. As they get further and farther, like the booby traps are really fun. Granted, I understand why they didn't want to do the booby traps again, because retracking over a few things that were just as funny back in FMA may not be as funny as in the visual gags. You know, the fact that he's like always downing himself because it's like, if I couldn't fit this, if I was normal size, it's like, dang it, I call myself small. And then, you know, just that the whole thing of him doing it. Granted, they have that one scene in Brotherhood where they do that, but in FMA, they don't. In FMA, they have that multiple scenes where he's just like barely getting out of it because he's short. And it's like him actually being like, at least I am short. And be like, oh, why? Just why? Him going through their own complex there. But then him having to, in FMA, having to deal with Cohen with the choice of actually killing people to actually create a philosopher stone. And him going in that dilemma and having his brother, you know, literally him, the possibility of, if he doesn't go through this, his brother just, you know, having to, you know, watch him create this possibility of a mistake. And not really wanting his body back because of, you know, through the uses of human transmutation or going through using humans to create a philosopher's stone. And there's just a lot of different, you know, him actually having to go through that. And granted, this is where we get introduced to Kimblee in the series. And granted, Kimblee in the, we actually get introduced to Kimblee in Brotherhood very early on in episode one.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Kimblee, it's set up very early on as both not only this, you know, psychopathic killer, which is something that you don't even really hear too much about in Full Metal Alchemist. He's also, you actually, I think, get to see a little bit of his transmutation circles there on his hands.
Yes, you do. And also, what's really interesting too, and in the Laboratory 5 in FMA, is that you actually get to see him use it and use it with the red water. And kind of introduces the fact that it's like this turmoil where Ed has to either do what he doesn't want to do, go against what his beliefs are in order to get his body back. I mean, I don't think he really cares as much about getting his body back as getting Al's body back, really, as it shows towards the end of the series. But him having to go through that, you know, moral question of, should I do this? Because the ends, because these are prisoners, these are not good people. You know, does the ends, what is it? What is the best word for that? The means, I guess?
Yeah, do the ends justify the means?
Thank you. Do the ends justify the means? There we go.
That's a very common moral argument that is in a lot of things, not just Full Metal Alchemist.
But also, you know, Scar actually looking at it and seeing what Ed is willing to do, and Scar actually willing to help him.
Yeah, going back on Kimblee, that ends justify the means. He's actually a very good example of a concept from a writing called The Prince, where one of the main themes is like, should a ruler rule by force? Kimblee kind of shows that. He's that very, you know, I'm going to murder, you know, use a psychopath as your enforcer kind of thing.
Honestly, he just does it because he thinks it's fun.
I mean, yeah, but it's definitely
because they go boom
force. that's probably one of the things about it that's very cool.
Yeah,
and also very, you know, crazy about him.
Oh yeah, I will definitely agree with that. And and Laboratory 5 is a great example too, because he has to rebuild up L again.
Yeah,
and granted, his arm gives out. He has to. Because of that one stupid bolt. I love the conversation between him and granted, this is also when we find out that the worst character did survive. Is the worst character in all of Full Metal. I hate him so much, which makes it really funny when being like, man, I really hate this character. I don't like this character at all. Is Shao Tucker. The fact that he actually survived is a travesty. Granted, that's the reason why Brotherhood, in my opinion, hands down, best anime. I like him equally. It's just the fact that Shao Tucker dies in Brotherhood is just, yeah, you should die. Die for all your transgressions.
He is a very hateable character. Helps a lot in him dying.
But also the introduction to Greed is a great in Laboratory 5 we're also introduced to Greed. And Greed is a fun character. And the fact that how he's stayed and you see the skull and basically how these homunculuses are made, and it is kind of showing you more and more into this world of how homunculuses are made, because how homunculuses are made in this world is different than in the than in Brotherhood.
Yeah.
How they're made is like two completely different ways.
And one of the other things is it shows with Greed, he has a entourage of the first like characters that we see that are like actual successful chimeras.
Yeah, talking basically human transformed chimeras, I guess.
Well, ones that can that can either freely transform or already in a like hybrid state, which is one of the things that beforehand was shown to be rather impossible or hard to do, because with the Father Cornello in Riol, he had a chimera that he kind of made, and Shao Tucker was working on chimeras. This Greed also shows the first like human chimeras that function properly, which is both great and slightly horrifying that they are these characters that actually function as these kind of chimeras, because they also kind of, destroyed some of their lives by being chimeras.
Yeah. Which FMA does give us a little bit more of, at this point, into the... We really don't get to see too much into Scar's past a little bit. We do get to see a little bit more of Scar's brother than we really want to see, but, that's a whole other, whole other thing in of itself. But it's kind of interesting, too, the fact that I think Scar actually does bring it up pretty quickly that Lust actually looks different, looks a lot similar to his brother's wife. I think it's his wife or his girlfriend. I don't remember what it was. It's like it's the one he tries to bring back. I don't remember if it's his wife or his girlfriend, Scar's brother.
No, which character you said?
Lust.
It was, I think it was his brothers. I don't know actually, because I don't think they actually explicitly say.
I don't know. I think they might explicitly say it, but it's like after.
pretty much they're they're lovers. They're if they haven't tied the knot, they pretty much were going to.
Yeah, and it's always interesting to see how they towards the end basically we can go into the Rush Valley is different. They do Rush Valley way different to in Brotherhood than they do in FMA, which the Rush Valley, I don't know, I kind of like the Rush Valley in FMA, but also like the Rush Valley in Brotherhood too. Granted, there's a lot less assault on Winry's parts, so I kind of go which one do I like better?
I kind of like the I kind of like the Brotherhood one, just because of them finding Ed's pocket, his alchemy, essentially certification, his pocket watch.
Yeah,
and that's where they start, going into their past. So it has the date. The very special date for all of them.
Yeah, but it also, I think it show they show the date before that too.
Yeah, and that's the part where you know, they've been saying like, oh, there's the state, oh, there's this thing. But that's when they, in Brotherhood at least, that they truly actually start jumping into that.
Yeah.
I think that's why I like the Brotherhood Rush Valley a little bit more, because they, you know, that's a very big story point for them.
Yeah. But I mean, they do that story point a little bit earlier on. They do that in, oh, yeah. I think around like episode 17 is really where they do it at. It's when Winry is like looking at and being like, I'm gonna look. But also, one thing I love about it is that is her lines of when they pull, when he has to call her up and be like, he's like dreading the call from her because it's like he has to tell her, I broke the automail again. And it's like, my arm starts moving. It has, you know, it's like, I can move my fingers, but I can't, you know, move my arm. It's like, that sounds about right. And that line is like, oh, nothing.
I think one of the, I think one of the cool things about Winry is, in a sense, you know, part of her identity is, she's very attached to her, to the automail that she made for Ed.
Mm-hmm.
And you actually kind of don't know why she is as into automail as you, as it is until a little bit later.
Yeah.
But, once you learn about it and why she's like actually very, you know, passionate about it, it adds so much to her. And I, mm-hmm. Even if you're watching, Fullmetal Alchemist or Brotherhood, I would probably say that like, once you learn about that, about her, mm-hmm. it really does add a lot to her. And yeah. It's really nice.
And then going into, I think another thing is the whole teacher appearance. Brotherhood and in FMA. I like the FMA one a lot better because I think it's funnier. The fact that his teacher is trying to hunt him down and the fact that she goes into the into the military. I think she goes to the military in Central and goes and tries to hunt him down and then finds out it's like, oh, he left. Okay. And basically just takes off as if she just like belongs there. And it's just like, what the heck? Okay.
Yeah.
And the fact that Ed is trying to run away is even better because it's the fact that he just gets like, granted, both I think both are really done really well in both Brotherhood and in FMA because both of them got a huge laugh out of me when I watched rewatching it. And I'm like, yeah, this is great no matter what you do. I think they're both done really, really well. But I think the one thing, and oh my goodness, we still have a lot more to talk about. Dang it. Because episode, like, because really where they both diverge from and really to the point where episode 34 is really where in FMA is where both Brotherhood and Brotherhood and FMA both diverge is about the death of Greed. When Greed dies, that's about when they diverge from. And granted, how each of these homunculi are made, granted, because we have Izumi's mistake with her child, with her trying to bring her child back with human transmutation. We do see the fact that, oh, this is how homunculi are made because of the mistakes that these alchemists are trying to bring their people back, the people they want, you know, their family back or whatever, you know, whatever reason why. Bringing these creatures back and the fact that how you actually beat them are, oh my goodness, is actually more insane. And it's something we'll probably talk about probably about next time or even the time after that, because I'm almost thinking that we're going to need like three different podcasts to be able to talk about the differences here.
Oh, probably.
Because I think each series has its own strengths and has its own weaknesses.
Yeah.
And I think the last thing we should probably talk about a little bit is it's episode 14. In Brotherhood, where they diverge, and as I said, the death of Greed is where they fully diverge from each other, where it's two completely different series after that.
Yeah.
Is how they treat Hughes and how they treat Hughes's death is done a lot more. They treat Hughes's death a lot more importance in FMA than they do in Brotherhood.
And I mean, to be fair for anyone who's listening, Hugh's death is very important in both series. Like, mm-hmm. it is a big turning point. And yes. it's extremely important in both.
But I feel like they tend to gloss yeah. over it in Brotherhood.
I mean, it's actually made quite a big deal.
Yeah, but it's like, it's not as much of a big deal because of the impact that it has, because in Brotherhood, they have the normal song going off, and it's just kind of that, like, it's kind of that footnote in the series. Granted, it still is, it's not as powerful as in the, I don't know if it's because of the voice that they got for Alicia or what it was, but there's certainly something about the FMA and what it does, especially when they're bearing Hughes and that, you know, the heartstrings of Alicia saying, like, you know, saying what she's saying about Hughes and saying that daddy needs to get up tomorrow, you know, if they bury him, da 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 da. You know, it's something that's yeah. really super sad. And in Brotherhood, it's just kind of like, oh, because they're going so fast and because they're going more towards, I mean, the manga.
They have that scene as well in Brotherhood, actually.
Yes, they do have that scene in Brotherhood. But it's just not as much, there's not as much impact. And after that, like, is after that scene in FMA, what it is just, it's just silence.
I mean,
so it's basically, it's a very heavy note to end on. And with Brotherhood, it's Roy basically coming up to the saying, like, okay, I'm going to become Fuhrer, you know, these things where he's like more resolved. And in a way where it's like, it's more somber in FMA. That's the reason why I say it's like, it's more, they knew that this was a heavy, heavy note to end on.
Yeah.
End the episode on, and they did it really, really well. And in Brotherhood, it's just kind of like, oh yeah, we have to go through Hughes' death. And it's kind of one of those things. It's kind of one of those notes we have to hit. It's just not done as, I don't think it's done as well as in FMA. Because of the fact that we've had more and more stuff with Hughes and we had more time to fall in love with him. And granted, yeah. with a lot of people, I could see it them, you know, being the same thing where it's like, oh my goodness, it's still just as good of a scene. I just don't think it's as good of a scene. Because I got done watching both of them and I watched them back to back. And like watching them back to back, you do definitely see a thing where it's like, it's just done a lot more, like.
Yeah, I think they're both done in a way that's emotionally impactful.
Mm-hmm.
I think the main difference to me, at least, is when I was watching them, is in Brotherhood, with the pacing of it, it's actually a little bit slower, but mm-hmm. the way they have the episode structured. Mm-hmm. Rather than kind of like delving on it, they kind of have it structured where they move forward a little bit faster.
Yes.
Because of the episode structure, mm-hmm. not necessarily because of the pacing.
Yeah.
The pacing for it, I think, is actually done in a very slower way that makes it a little bit more emotionally impactful as a scene, especially where Roy kind of states his resolve. But mm-hmm. because the episodes after that, the episode structures are made so that once they're done with certain plot points, they can kind of jump onto the next one.
Yeah. It's
kind of more like they have it structured where they're kind of jumping onto the next plot point soon after.
Yeah. Yeah.
Less so that it actually feels like they're kind of moving faster. More mm-hmm. so, they just have it structured where they're going to jump to the next plot point. Because to me, at least, it feels like they actually hold on to the scene, especially about the funeral, a little bit longer.
Yes.
In Brotherhood, it feels like it's longer, but that's because of how the episode
yeah.
structure is.
Yeah.
The episode structure gives it more time to be longer. Because they know in the next episodes that they're going to jump into the next plot points. Mm.
But it's a little bit, I will say it's a little bit, I don't know if it's a little bit longer. I think it might be around the same distance. It might be a little bit more, it might be a little bit more longer because you do have, you know, Roy with his infamous, it's going to rain scene, you know, it's raining yeah. scene. And but the thing is the, how they end, especially with Ed and Al on the train with Winry and on their way to Rush on their way to Rush Valley, and then you see Hughes just, you know, waving to him, the ghost of Hughes, you know, it's something that is. But there's one thing though, I do have to admit the manga does, I got a kick out of it too, is the basically the volume where he dies, or I don't know if it's the volume or the chapter he dies, it's an In Memoriam, yeah. and it's him with the suit of armor showing pictures of Alicia and his wife. It's just yeah. like, that's the best send off you could ever do, and annoying the crap of the suit of armor too.
Yeah, I would say like Hughes is one of those yeah. characters that he's well loved, and the fact that you know, he gets that emotional response really helps the fact yeah. that like he is the reason why a lot of the changes that did happen.
Yeah. So I think that because of the yeah. fact that they spent so much more time on him in FMA than they did in Brotherhood, it kind of does tend to feel like, oh, this is kind of a footnote a little bit. Excuse me. It's not really meant to be like a bad thing because it's just a footnote, but it's just not as much because of the fact that you didn't spend as much time with him. Granted, if you watched FMA, then you're probably might have the same reaction to where it's like, oh, you know it's coming, but you just don't want to go, you know, you're going to have to go through it, and you might have the same reaction to it in both of them. But I feel like the one in FMA does it a little bit more. Yes, it does kind of go into a little bit more of the, it ends kind of in a way how, what is it? Infinity War ended, the part one.
Okay, yeah.
And kind of how that ended, where it's just that somber moment of just like, because it's one of those things where it's always stuck into my brain how it ended, because I was in the theater and it was a packed theater when I was in, and it was just quiet. It was yeah. like deathly quiet. Like you probably could have heard a pin drop. And it was just like a lot of people were just like, huh. Wait, what did I just watch? Kind of thing where it's just like, man, it is powerful, and it is just anytime you get a series like that, like ReZero does that a lot, where you have a lot of those moments where it's just a super powerful moment, and they know to not really add it. You know, there's nothing else you can add to that moment. There's nothing else you can do to this series, to this episode, to where when they end it, they don't end it with the normal ending theme. They do it with a different theme, with just the black screen and just letting you think about what just happened, kind of thing. And it's like, I like that. And that to me feels a lot more impact on his death, because I know that Hughes is kind of in the manga and in Brotherhood is just basically a side character that everyone really loved.
Yeah.
And in Brotherhood, they do treat him well, and they treat his death very well, actually, with him turning into his wife, especially because how Envy knows what his wife looks like in FMA is a little bit sus, but
I mean,
because I don't think there's a picture, but on the ground you see the picture where Envy actually sees the picture, and then when he turns around trying to kill Envy and his wife is staring back at him, that is actually a little bit more impactful than in FMA.
I think that point, actually, that's very interesting. I think they did that to kind of prove that also, like, the homunculi have a huge information network.
Mm-hmm.
Because in a sense, like, one of the things about Envy is that he, you know, that he, they, whatever you want to call them.
Well, technically, it's a he. It's been confirmed that it's a he.
Well, it's more like they don't really have a gender is the problem. Well,
they actually do. It has actually confirmed in both FMA and in Brotherhood that it is he. But in FMA, he doesn't remember what he looks like.
I mean,
that's the reason why he has the
Well, the homunculi are, well, specifically Envy is kind of genderless, but that's because of his true form.
Yeah.
Because his true form is, you know, a little like monster thing, like a leech.
But also it's not his that's only in Brotherhood, but in FMA his true form is basically what you I think it's basically what you see, I believe.
In the 2003 one, it's also kind of weird because homunculi are made completely different.
Yes.
And I won't go too much into that.
Because I don't think we really have that much time. We're getting into the...
Yeah, one of the things about Envy transforming into Hugh's wife, though, that's very interesting is the fact that, you know, it kind of also shows that homunculi have this huge information network that goes beyond the state government. And I think that actually helps show that,
mm-hmm.
which is why they're able to do all the stuff that they're able to do in the story.
Yeah,
it kind of explains that because it's like, oh yeah, they have information that, you know, it also kind of alludes to some homunculi's identity because they're the only ones who can get them that kind of information.
Yeah.
But I think that's most of the beginning parts. Beginning, big air quotes, because we kind of go, what, 30-some episodes in.
But I mean, that right there is like not even 30, but like the death of Hughes is not even 30 episodes in. But we're not even like, oh boy. I did not think this through when I was like, oh yeah, this is only going to take two different podcasts. I realize now, my mistake, it's going to take about 3 or 4.
But I would say the parts, one of the things to end on is probably the parts where people can watch on before they get major splits.
I will say for like
other parts.
Mm-hmm. For FMA.
One of the things I want to preface is that for Fullmetal Alchemist from 2003, there is creative differences that are taken much early on.
Mm-hmm.
Things like Lyra showing up in episode 9. She's completely unique to the Fullmetal Alchemist 2003 anime.
Yeah.
But in a sense, that doesn't necessarily create a huge difference in where the anime Fullmetal Alchemist and Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood kind of diverge.
Yeah.
Not yet, at least. It's, as mentioned before, it's kind of more towards the greed stuff, and probably even a little bit before that because of how the greed stuff is handled. It's you could probably say that, you know, episode 33 is where the straight up like differences happen.
Mm-hmm.
But you could also say it happens even a little bit before. So,
well, it's actually 34, but you know, hey. Yeah. I feel like that nerd where it's like, actually it's actually not episode 33, it's like 34.
Yeah.
But you know,
My recommendations for people is probably actually around episode 20, believe it or not. That's because that's when, like, the Laboratory 5 stuff, where the huge changes in Laboratory 5 happens. If you want a full, like, jump off to Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood. And that's if you want, like, the full manga experience. If you want the full experience of Fullmetal Alchemist, it's not a bad series. We both like it.
Mm-hmm.
And if there's even word from Hiromi Arakawa, the person who has written and made Fullmetal Alchemist, she even said she's fine and likes the Fullmetal Alchemist anime. So, you know, take it from the creator. You know, it's still not a bad one.
Yeah. One thing about Fullmetal, you know, it's like the one thing about this series is it is definitely one of my favorite anime of all time. It is definitely in the top 10 anime of all time. For me, both Fullmetal Alchemist and Brotherhood are both like, I both love them absolutely. A lot of people will say, oh, Brotherhood is better than FMA. And I will tell you this, and I always stand by it, and I think I've stand by this like forever in a year, is that I believe that they're the same. And a lot of it, because a lot of what they're dealing with different topics. Brotherhood, I think, is dealing, it might be a little bit better than FMA, but I still believe they're both really good. And I think if us going into this, and I don't know if we're going to go into it again next week, or if it'll be the week after we get back into, you know, going back into the differences, because we haven't even like touched the shows yet. And I think it's about time we stopped here. We had to stop here because we haven't even touched the, which is insane to think about that. We haven't even touched the surface of the series. And there's so much more left, and especially because of the stuff that's coming up and everything that, you know, that we're about to deal with all the new characters in Brotherhood coming out, coming up after episode 14, that are basically manga characters that are actually coming to the story for the first time ever. And the one thing I can say about Brotherhood than FMA, FMA feels like it's very much, it doesn't feel like a very open world. While as Brotherhood feels like there's a lot more countries, it feels a lot more open, it feels a lot more complete world than FMA does. But what FMA does, it does really well. So,
yeah. As a reference to this, it's the main country that they're in, Amestris, totally not Germany, totally not Nazi Germany or anything like that, is the main setting, and it's pretty much where everything takes place. They mention two places, Xing and Ishbal. Totally not being China, of course.
Which is really funny, though, that you have Ishbal in Brotherhood, but then you have Ishbal in FMA.
Yeah, and there's history between all these countries, but they go a lot more into some of these other countries. Now, Amestris itself, though, has a lot of world building in both. So, yeah. So you don't have to worry about the main setting not having world building. But the foreign countries having it is very nice.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. But with that being said, I think that's about where we probably need to stop right now. Because if we keep going, we're going into that 2-hour mark territory, which I said, you know, tonight was going to be like, oh, we're only going to do it like an hour. I want to make sure of it. But we're getting into it. And it's just like, dang it. There's so much more to talk about with, like, there's so many good things to talk about with Brotherhood and with FMA that you could just keep. I could talk about these things for hours and hours, and I find it really fascinating between the two series and how the series are alike and not alike at the same time.
Oh yeah.
So with that being said, go check out both of these series. It's both available on Netflix, and Brotherhood is available on Funimation, and the movie Conqueror of Shambhala is available on Crunchyroll. Yeah, so hopefully you have Crunchyroll or Burp.
Yeah.
I have no idea why Conqueror Shambhala is, like, of all things, it's like not on Netflix, not on Funimation, but on Crunchyroll. That makes sense somewhere.
I mean,
I have
maybe no they just idea. Didn't want it.
I don't know. It just seems weird. But but do not watch Conqueror of Shambhala before FMA, because, and then go into Brotherhood, because that's just the worst way to possibly go into it.
Yeah, there's definitely a order, and watching some of the movies first won't help.
Yeah. So with that being said, guys, thank you so much for watching. This has been Zain and
Teketria. Yeah.
And we'll see you guys on the flip side.